Joan Quinn Profiles. As an editor for Andy Warhol's Interview, the Los Angeles Herald Examiner, LA Style, and Detour magazines, Joan covered the social set, the Hollywood hotshots, the international art scene, the mysteries of food, the excitement of travel, and the fabulous world of fashion. Joan continues to find creative people on the cutting edge who make things happen. Here's Joan Agajanian Quinn.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome to the Joan Quinn Profiles. Waiting to be profiled are R. Ernie Silva and actress Sally Kellerman. Actor, playwright Ernie Silva was born and raised in Brooklyn. After high school, he spent a year at John Jay School of Criminal Justice, and before being kicked out, he earned a BA in theater, or after being kicked after out me. In a year, after mm-hmm. the first year, huh? Mm-hmm. He earned a BA in theater from Southern Illinois University and an MFA in acting from USC. Mm-hmm. Ernie was the youngest in a family of 13, all living in the Bushwick projects. His breakdancing drew the attention of the people at 98.7 KISS FM, and that's where you fell in love with the live audience. How, were you bitten by the bug before that?
I come from like a long line of musicians, I had experience that at even a younger age than that, like watching them perform live and stuff, and so I had already sort of had the intrigue, but yeah, I think breakdancing was where it sort of caught me, like, oh wow, this is immediate.
So that was like stage stuff, right?
Yeah.
So, and music lessons? Did you take music lessons?
No, never. Never.
Do you know how to play like Segovia and Hendrix and your idols?
I've taken lessons, but they've been like, hey, I want to show you something on the guitar, or hey, I'm going to pay for 3 lessons here, scattered throughout. For the most part, me learning how to play the guitar has been me in closets and bathrooms, irritated with myself as I was rewinding whatever Hendrix was doing or whatever, you know, Robert Johnson was doing.
But who were the rest of your influences as far as music?
Musically,
I mean, you had a lot, didn't you?
Yeah, I had a ton of them. Hendrix, obviously, was one of my main influences. I adored, Segovia and John McLaughlin and Paco de Lucia, and of course, like in the rap era, like Rakim and Eric B and KRS-One and people like that.
But those people seem a little bit like in the rock and in the rap were a little more accessible, but people like Segovia, I mean, how could that influence you? And in your show, you play that.
Yeah.
Show me a little bit while we're talking about it, yeah.
Okay. Because this was actually actually written by Ibanez Isaacs in the late 1800s, but Segovia was the one that transposed it.
1800s, yeah. And this is influencing you.
Yeah, definitely.
So tell us why you were kicked out of John Jay's.
Oh, wow. How much time do we have?
You were only there a year. It can't take you that long to tell us.
Well, I would say I was kicked out just because I was 18 and living in Bushwick Projects and all the amenities that come with that sort of thing.
So by the time you got to college, though, which was a good college, how did you get into that college?
And you mean John Jay or SIU?
Yeah, SIU.
It was funny. I was living in St. Louis, Missouri at the time. And I was kind of traveling around quite a bit and sleeping at people's couches and things of that nature for the sake of, I don't know, doing stand-up or playing guitar or what have you. And right when I wanted to go back to school, I was living with some friends of mine who were commuting to Edwardsville every day. And they were like, well, if you want to go back to school, this is the time to do it. And I did.
That was the time.
Oh, yeah.
And it was fantastic. It's always some kind of motivation like that, isn't it?
It was easy
for you because they were going.
Yeah, it just kind of presented itself.
But you know, going to USC for a master's program is not that easy. I mean, that's pretty heady stuff, and you had to come out and look for that. And I understand you got a scholarship.
I was very fortunate. It was the first class of the new program, and they were literally auditioning people from all over the world.
How did you get a scholarship? I mean, there were 360. I mean, they had come down to 360, and you got a scholarship out of that small group.
I don't know. Just serendipity, I guess.
You must have been really good. What did you do to audition?
I found out about the audition from an acting coach that I had been working with in L.A. for a couple of years before that. Her name is Charlotte Cornwell. And when she asked me to go and audition for the program, I was like, God, I can't go back to school with theater people. I just can't. I can't, man. I can't do another 3 years with theater people, man. She's like, well, you should consider it. It'll be a really great opportunity. So I went, all right. I filled out the application. And I went to the audition. I'm like, yeah, all right. They're not going to call me back. And they did.
And they did.
And they did. And they did until finally, you know, they only gave away one full scholarship that year, and they gave it to me. So I'm like, well, I guess I'm going back to school then.
Yeah, but that was another thing that just happened. Somebody, you were in the right place, and someone told you to go, and the talent came out, and you did it.
Yeah.
And then while you were in this acting program, you wrote, okay, let's say it, Heavy Like the Weight of a Flame.
Yes, ma'am.
And tell me why you wrote that.
Well, I co-wrote it with a novelist named James Gabriel. And
but why write it with James Gabriel when it's your story? Why can't you write it?
Well, because writing is its own art form, and it has structure that I wasn't very clued in about. You know, in terms of a long piece, like a 70-minute piece, I just wasn't, you know, and through serendipity again, I meet this guy who's like, hey, I'm looking to write this.
You didn't know him either? And
no.
He wrote your, well, and then I'm going to ask you how you got the director.
Mary Jo Negro. Oh, wow.
Same
Mary
thing,
Joan,
right?
Was a professor at USC at the time. She had just started working at USC. And I remember I walked into her class accidentally one morning when she was teaching, because I was looking for a place to rehearse, you know. And I walked in, I went, sorry. Oh. She's like, come in, you know.
She's very cool.
Yeah,
she said, anyone
cool.
who wants to sit in our class could come in.
Absolutely. And then we talked and found out she was from Brooklyn as well, and that was kind of our kinship. And so
that happened, and you asked her to direct you?
I sure did. I got the opportunity to have the show produced by a small theater company that works out of USC.
Oh, that's how it happened, because it's at the Odyssey Theater.
It's at the Odyssey now, yeah.
And it's in a black box.
In a black box.
And so tell us, because there's black boxes within black boxes, and you make us believe that those black boxes are mountains and railroad cars. And
well, that's largely to do with Mary Jones, a really acute attention to detail. And I guess I still have kind of a six-year-old's imagination when it comes to that sort of thing.
And you take your guitar Savannah with you everywhere.
Yeah, I do.
You're kind of mean to her, though.
Well, in the story, just because, you know, she's kind of taking the batterings and the pings and knocks with me.
She
does
take the battering with you.
Because it's all autobiographical, so she's, you know, she's kind of in there getting lashed with me.
Well, what else goes on in the story? You leave home. That's the bitter part. Mm-hmm. It's very sad. Tell us a little bit about that.
Basically, I leave home like I did about 3 weeks before my 21st birthday, and I started to experience this sort of new life. Like, I had read a lot of Kerouac and Ginsberg, and, you know, I loved people like, you know, Hendrix and Richard Pryor, who seemed to be like these wanderers who had this kind of like wisdom about, like, or at least what I perceived to be wisdom. You know what I mean? And I wanted to live like that before I went back to my cradle, because I started doing stand-up when I was 17.
So you were really out on the road. You left home right pretty
much.
7 years.
Is that
what it was?
Yeah,
before
it was
about
7 years.
To university?
Oh, yeah.
And
Well, I went to SIU in that 7-year period.
During that
time. And
then
USC was years after, almost about 6 years after.
So what do you prefer, film or theater?
Well, I honestly, that's a really great question, actually. I want to have the type of career that like a Whoopi Goldberg has, or like a John Leguizamo, because they're kind of anomalous, and they can go from stage to screen or to TV, and people will respect them in any genre that they choose.
But they're not musical like you. You have another added dimension.
Well, that's what I'm hoping will connect to people, you know.
Could you get on the stage and just do a pure music thing?
To date, I haven't ever done it, but I could see it happening, yeah.
Do you write?
Music, no, I'm completely illiterate.
It's all by ear?
Yeah.
And there is music in your play.
Oh, yeah.
So why do a one-person play like that?
Well, to chime in again on, I was always an avid admirer of people like Rich Pryor, Flip Wilson, and you feel, after years and years, you feel like you know them.
Yeah.
And I think that that's because of their canon of work. Mm-hmm. You know, like, Richard Pryor didn't give you his entire story in his first show. You just felt like you knew him because of all the experiences he would talk about, and that's what I wanted to bring to my stage.
Oh,
life.
As he was talking, you got to know him.
Yeah,
so
well,
that's
through
why
act,
you
through his shows.
I see. But you have to do lots of one-person shows then.
Yeah. Well, Heavy is the beginning of a trilogy, actually.
Oh, it is. Yeah. Oh, I was going to ask you, on your career path, where do we go next?
Second part.
And what will that be? Bring you to L.A.?
I'm not quite sure yet if I'm going to, because I deal with a lot of high concept ideas in the show.
Yeah, they're very...
Yeah, they're sort of esoteric and stuff. And I think that the second show, as I've been being like warranted by people that I know, is like the second show has to be about what happened, like artistically what happened to you. So
why you got there.
Right.
I see. And the third?
And the third one...
Have you gone that far?
Yeah, I think that the third one will deal largely with what I feel like will maybe happen when I'm not here anymore.
Oh, interesting. Esoteric as well.
Yeah. I think
you kind of were in a dream world, I thought, on the stage a lot. Or you put us on a dream world.
Yeah, I mean, I find it's the easiest place to be able to communicate with people if you can kind of open them up in that sort of, like, theater can be hypnotic.
Yeah, that's how it felt.
And that's how the music used, you know, that's how I use the music and stuff. And once people are in that place and they're really listening to you, then you can kind of dialogue with them even if they're not speaking back to you.
Yeah. Ernie, our Ernie, my Ernie, our Ernie, thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me.
And thanks for being with us. Don't go away, because Sally Kellerman will be right back. Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and I'm with award-winning actress, singer, Sally Kellerman, who was born in Long Beach, where I was born, and raised in Los Angeles, where she attended Hollywood High, Los Angeles City College, and the Actors Studio in Los Angeles. You've seen her in hundreds of feature films, TV shows, and on the stage. You've heard her voice on countless commercials and on CDs, especially the critically acclaimed new CD called Sally. She's been nominated for an Oscar and a Golden Globe. And was Hollywood High the start of your career path?
Oh, right to Schwab's. No, absolutely not.
It wasn't.
That was Lana Turner. No. No, it was where I could eat and get fat, you know, on Hollywood Boulevard, you know, afterwards at the coffee shop. It was great.
But
I loved it so
much.
They
had a fabulous theater department, and they have a lot of great actors from Hollywood High.
Yeah, well, I didn't know any of the actors when I was there, you know, but I did. I get to play the mother in Meet Me in St. Louis, because I was the biggest one in the class. And actually, my friend Hooper C. Dunbar III's mother came, and she sent my picture in to an audition for Joan of Arc. Gene Seberg did it. And there were like thousands of people. It was a big contest, you know. And she sent my picture in just from seeing me in that
play.
You
do look very Joan of Arc today.
I am very
beautiful,
right? Thank you. Just I tried to. That was my thought. And so that is funny that you'd say that. But then I stood in line with like 1,000 people, you know, and then. Just when I memorized my little speech, and just ahead of me, the girl went, "Oh God," and she looked up, and I thought, "Oh, I have to look up," and I went, "Oh God!" And he said, "Thank you very much." And I was out of there. That was it. Right here. Yeah.
But no
evidently,
one
was. I was not as convincing as the girl in front of me.
But they did have great teachers there, and also L.A. City College. Did you?
Oh,
did you?
Please! I went to L.A. City College for my mother.
Oh, for
and
your mother?
My dad, sure.
But not I mean, take acting lessons?
Absolutely not. I was there for a semester. They said, never quit, because, you know, and always you can always come back. And the first moment I saw Eddie Burns from the series, you know, Kooky Lemmy, except he wasn't in a series at that time, you know. That was the end of school for me. And I always wanted to be an actress. And right out of high school, Norma Jean Nielsen, she was a child actress in radio. And some actor came to speak at the school, and I said, well, I'm going to study with him because I really do want to be an actor. She said, well, if you're serious, I'm going to take you to Jeff Corey.
Oh, because he was fantastic.
Oh, he was fantastic. And so that was the summer I got out of high school. See, so by the time I got to L.A. City College, and they were teaching pantomime, which I wish I had learned, but it was like Jeff's ate pantomime. You know, I was like, yeah. And you know,
you actually then got all of your training with Jeff. I mean, your really intense training.
It was a great thing. And my class was Jack Nicholson, Roger Corman, Carol Eastman, Robert Town, Bobby Blake, James Coburn.
Really?
You know, yeah, all these. I mean, yes, it was amazing. And you know how much he charged us? There's a singing teacher that I think is wonderful, but he charges $200 an hour. And I mean, that's certainly his privilege, and he's talented and everything like that. But where does anyone go to get a really good teacher? You know, Jeff charged $10. I think it was $10 a week or $10 a month. And we went twice a week at night for like 2 or 3 hours.
And did you all interact?
That was before that was in the dark ages.
Right. But did you interact with the other actors?
Yeah.
Were you acting with them
and
you were doing scenes?
Sure, yeah.
And then were you singing at the time? Because you have a voice.
I was under contract to Verve at 18, again the summer. I had so you're right, Hollywood High. Don Adams was one of my closest friends, and she knew Norman Granz. So I sang with a group called the Four Preps. They were singing, but they moonlighted with me and Norma Jean, you know, because we loved the Four Freshmen, and they were more like high-lows. So
you sang in a group.
Just privately, not for anybody, but I always put shows together from junior high and all through high school. I'd get a trio, and we would sing and giggle. But Lincoln Mayorga was a keyboard guy, and so we made a demo in my living room. And Norman Granz got it, and they signed me to Verve. Barney Kessel signed me. But I didn't ever make a recording, and I don't really know what happened.
But Norman Granz was really big in music,
it was big.
Right?
Verve Records was huge. And
really
so,
big.
And I remember being on Balboa Island with Jack Nicholson came with his girlfriend, and we were at my parents' house, and I went to a phone booth and got the call, and I was so excited, but I was so neurotic, you know. I mean, I was kind of heavy and scared. And then I'd always wanted to be an actress, too. I just never was going to do one without the other, you know.
Oh, you are, so did you when you went into...
So when I started into class, you know, you could do something right there with somebody and you didn't have to stand out in front of the band, you know, all by yourself.
I see, yeah.
Even though now we realize I'm not by myself, I got this great band, you know, I mean, it's like, but it took me years and so then the acting took hold. I did plays in a church and this and that and the other thing. It wasn't like an instant stardom, I'll tell you, no matter what they did, no matter who my friends were at Hollywood High.
It doesn't matter, right?
It took me a long time.
Was there a turning point in your life that led you to this Oscar nomination or this Golden Globe nomination?
I did smaller parts in television. You know, I started with one line and then, you know, because I was tall or something, and Alexis Smith. But then the real beginning of awareness that I actually existed, you know, was Joe Stefano, who wrote the screenplay of Psycho, saw me in a play in a little theater on Vine Street and said, I saw you in another play 6 months ago and the growth is amazing and I may do a series, and if I do, and I was working as a waitress, and I thought, sure, I'll be in the restaurant for the rest of my life. And 6 months later, he sent me a script. He was kind of old Hollywood, and he said, the part is Ingrid, the magic is yours.
Oh.
And it was an Outer Limits.
How great.
And Conrad Hall and William Fraker.
Fantastic.
Were the cameraman. They were the cameraman and operator, you know. And,
fantastic, and weren't they? The two best.
Oh, my God. And they're such darling guys. It was the first time I fell in love with a beard. You know, they were both so handsome and so talented. And Joe Stefano said, all right, to the director, does she understand her motivation? And she turned to these two guys. I didn't know how.
Motivation.
Yeah. they make her look like a movie star. And I had, you know, short brown hair with a fat face, but they gave me a muskrat collared thing and a cigarette, you know, and I never stopped working after that. I went and cried.
See, that was like a big, that was a turning point.
That was a big thing. That was a major turning point. So that was my television career, and I did, you know, Kraft and Chrysler and started.
Were you singing too, or just acting?
I was taking lessons and,
you were still just taking,
I was still working on the music, yeah. And so then, you know, I mean, I did, you know, I had two lines of Reform School Girl in the movie, and then I, you know, things like that. And I was in a little part in Boston Strangler and April Fool with Jack Lemmon. But then I went to this meeting and for Lieutenant Dish in the movie MASH. And never wore lipstick, you know, because my sister used to call me, shut up, big lips. And so I was always hiding my mouth. So that day I thought, well, Dish, I got to wear red lips. So I go to this meeting, and there's a bunch of men in the room, and the one guy is evidently the director, and about 10 minutes into the meeting, he says, I'll give you the best part in the picture, Hot Lips. And I said, oh, my God. And so I went out, and I counted the lines. I looked for my part. I couldn't even find it, you know, and I just like, I'll never get in the movies, which is what I'd always, you know, it was one of my big dreams. And I almost didn't go back and see him, but I did, and...
And it was Robert Altman.
It was Robert Altman, and I had tears, and I, you know, huffed and puffed. Why couldn't she stay in the movie, and why doesn't she do this and that? And he goes, why couldn't she? Why don't you end up with something or nothing, you know? And so therein started a great love.
What a fabulous guy. Was he just absolutely brilliant? I mean, I met him and was with him a little bit, but not like...
The thing is that as an actress, an actor, you know, he just had that gift that made you feel like... He gets you. He know, he sees who you are, and he likes who you are, and he, you know, and then he lets you bring whatever you're going to bring.
But that's probably true, because he did see you, he liked you, and he brought you into his circle, right?
He didn't have to check with 400 people. He just said, I'll give you the part.
Yeah, see, and he liked you.
He liked me. He liked
And so he had to understand you. Do you do a cabaret act?
Well, yeah,
singing act.
I sing, yeah, and I have this new CD, Sally, that I'm so thrilled.
Tell us a little bit about, because you were just in San Francisco singing.
I will. I'll tell you about it. You know, I'm long-winded, so anytime you want to go like this, I understand. You know, Sally, just cut to the chase. You
I'm going to show the back of the, because it's pretty.
Too.
Yeah.
But it's got all these classic musicians that have been on every hit record that you ever heard, like Lee Sklar and Dean Parks and Russ Kunkel and... Just so many, and I have a very famous producer who won the Album of the Year with Betty Davis, Kim Carnes. Not with Sally, no.
Oh.
Not yet.
Okay.
This is new. This is just recently released. So I know it was Betty Davis as Kim Carnes. He did that. He got the Album of the Year.
Yeah,
and he worked with James Taylor and Bonnie Raitt and Linda Ronstadt. And he started, Hal David, Bacharach and David, I was in Lost Horizon. I sang in... Any place, like I do movies I shouldn't have done because there was a song in it, you know. But then I did Lost Horizon, and I'd known Bert and loved Bert. And then Hal and I connected on a trip to Israel, and he has just been in my corner and had me in all these gold
Hal
circle
David,
events,
fantastic.
He's the loveliest man. And
fantastic.
And at one of these events that he had me sing, Chris Caswell was the musical director. And at the end of it, and it was, you know, James Ingram and Patty Austin.
Oh, right.
And just all, he had me singing with everybody, all these great people. And at the end of it, we were having dinner, and he said, you know, you have to work with Chris Caswell. I thought, I work with Michael Orling. He said, well, that's good for you. And Michael Orling can play anything he now
Michael
is
Michael Orling,
yeah,
right.
I love Michael. He's now American Idol. But the timing was perfect because he got that job just when Hal said, you have to work with Chris Caswell. I've seen you sing too many wrong songs. That's
it. Oh, and they tell you what to do and how to do it.
And when he did, and then he went over to Chris and he said, Chris, you have to work with Sally. And we've just had four of the greatest years.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, it is. And
so do they write your cabaret show?
I don't think, I don't know what I have a prejudice against the word cabaret.
Oh, is that what we don't like that?
I don't know why, and it may be that is what it is, but there's something about the word. I hate to be like labeled.
Okay.
I'm such a rebel.
Well,
you
then
know,
it isn't cabaret.
My whole life away, you know.
Then it isn't cabaret.
Well, it is. It's it's intimate. Whether I'm on a stage at the McCallum or whether I'm in a small stage like Genghis Khan where we work out, to me it's intimate. And if intimacy and connecting the audience is cabaret, then I'm there. You know.
Okay.
What I'm saying?
Never mind.
And
let's
there's
talk
a lot of great cabaret singers.
Let's talk about Teatro Zanzani.
All right.
Because that's what you've done it three times, and
yes,
that's what
I
you're
going
to do.
This is my third time.
So
yeah.
Tell us a little bit about that, because I think that's very interesting.
Well, it is interesting, and it's
What is it? Cirque du Soleil?
Well, it's kind of Cirque du Soleil for dinner. You know, it's an intimate Cirque du Soleil. It's, you don't know who these people are, and maybe they're not the greatest actors, and they're running around being maids and waiters and everything like that. And then, you know, but and it's a, the soup comes hot, and it's in this beautiful, it's called a
tent. Yeah.
What is that famous
tent? I forget the name, but it's a tent in San Francisco.
There are only four of them in the world. And
oh, Spiegel.
Spiegel.
Spiegel tent.
So those of you who know all about Spiegel tents are all set. But it took me a year to go up there. Stephen Haves was...
They kept begging you to come up.
He kept calling me and he'd say, it's circus people in a tent and you get to sing a little bit. And I'm like, oh boy, you know, I think I'd rather just get on the road and do my own show. So I kept saying no, and finally I went up. The food was delicious. They were all these people, these aerialists and five generations.
Oh, during dinner?
People run around during
but
dinner.
But I mean during?
Talk to you, and but you're there, yes. It's like
what
this.
Do you do? You're Madam
so I'm
somebody.
Madam Zanzani, and one year I was Madam Buttercup or something, and I got the opening night, I went, and I'm Madam Butterball, you know, so that I'm famous up there for being Madam Butterball.
But anyway, Madam Zanzani, what do you wear?
They change. They make your beautiful gowns. They make all the costumes. And Melba Moore has just been up there. And this part changes. And it's usually built around, like, would be built around my new CD, Sally.
I see.
Which you can look on my website, sallykellerman.com.
Is that what they do? They build it around what you?
Well, they usually, my character. And
how great.
And I'm coming in, you know, singing gypsies, tramps, and thieves in a wagon, you know, with people leaping all about. But the talent there is just astounding. And at the end of that night, I thought, well, it's great, but I don't know circus people. I don't know, you know, five generation foot jugglers. You go, and then you go see them, and you go, oh, my God.
How
it's just amazing.
I know.
And so I went back where they're all having dinner, and it's a tradition in the circus, you know, big tables with bottles of wine and all the food that's left, and you can eat from the kitchen, you know. And I got back there, and I went, oh, I see your people. Oh, you're in show business.
Did you want to be a part of it then after that?
Oh, yeah, I did.
I mean, and it was like a family?
Oh, I just adore it. And, you know, a lot of Russians and different people, you know. And so the guy that I always work opposite, Voronin, he's very famous in Europe. And it's like European
And it's on
circus,
Pier,
no
what?
Animals.
Pier 29
I guess
or something?
So, Pier 29.
Something like that.
It's in the Embarcadero.
Yeah, Embarcadero.
And probably there isn't a person in San Francisco who's ever seen it. You know, locals like L.A., you know how we don't
We don't go? Well, I want to go up and see it.
Yeah.
And how long do you play in that role?
Well, I'm just doing it for 3 weeks. The last two summers I've done it for six, but right now... And they've asked me to do 2 months in Seattle, but, you know, my twins...
It started in Seattle.
It did, yeah. And it's wonderful, but I love San Francisco. So any chance I go, I didn't want to take 2 months to go up there because I'm doing other things, you know.
But in between,
but
you
weeks,
sing on the stage.
Between,
you don't do that.
Yes, and so the reason you asked me about my CD Sally is that we've been staying, like once a month, Chris and I, Chris Caswell, we go to Genghis Khan, this funky little
right on Fairfax.
Place, great Chinese food, and it's just a little club. And my older daughter Claire says, "I love to tell people that my mom works out at Genghis Khan." You know, a lot of young artists go in there and work.
They do.
Out.
A lot of people.
So I'm a young artist, and I'm in there working. But anyway, Val Corée came in. Garay came in one night with a friend, and just started coming back. About 18 shows later, that's how we happened to.
Oh, that's so great!
So it is. It's an exciting time for me, you know.
And I'm so glad you came to share it with us.
Me too, Joan. So nice to see you.
Thank
and
you.
I wanted to ask you about Frank and our mutual friend. So we'll
Frank
do that later.
Gehry, our mutual friend,
yeah.
And also Hal David's. We bought Hal David's house, Mac
you did.
David. Yes, Mac David, his brother, was his brother. Was Hal David's brother.
No, not Mac David, the singer.
No, that Mac Davis. Mac David.
Oh, Mac David. Oh, I don't know his brother.
Yeah, his
oh,
brother.
I see.
So there we have a lot of connections. 6 degrees.
Yeah, it is.
And
sure.
Thank you for being our 6 degrees today. And keep writing JA Quinn 1 at AOL. We'll see you next time.